With a gunshot wound, that's high velocity, high force. It can cause almost any type of internal injury.
He's been shot with a small caliber gun.
That's one of the bullets.
Oh.
There are security concerns with that patient.
That gunshot went off for a reason. What was that reason? Am I in a dangerous situation right now?
Would you rescue me? What about myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you get my back?
We're gonna staple your head back together.
There is a possibility he might die.
Good morning, Robin Hospital.
Good morning, Old Melbourne. My officer's doing here. We've loaded with a 20-year-old male, 3 gunshot wounds to the lower back.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, an urgent call has come through from paramedics, rushing a critically injured gunshot victim to emergency.
Three individual bullet wounds to his back.
Royal Melbourne received. We'll see you in 15 over. Thank you.
Senior emergency doctor Sarah Whitelaw needs to quickly pull together a trauma team, but high patient demand is stretching resources.
We've got 15 people currently getting prepared for the trauma, but we've also got another 30 patients waiting. That can be a bit of a challenge. He may need quite a number of significant procedures done down here.
Dr. Sarah has very little information about the victim's injuries, so her team's preparing for all possibilities.
I'll just ring the blood bank.
In a gunshot victim, the injuries can be really unpredictable because some bullets are designed to actually explode inside the body cavity and do the maximum amount of damage. And what I'm thinking is there problems with bleeding that we need to stop that's going to cause this gentleman to bleed to death within a matter of seconds to minutes?
With so many other patients needing help today, emergency nurse Maddie White has only just left her last patient.
This place is nuts.
It's so important to do 100% all the time and not get compassion fatigue and not, you know, give everything to one patient and not give anything to the next. You have to give everything all the time. I began my nursing 4 years ago in rural Victoria, little country town emergency department. It's about 8 beds. Comparing the difference, rural Melbourne's huge.
The gunshot victim arrives under heavy police guard.
So if the police are here, what are we doing about security?
The shooter is still on the loose, and there are fears he may try to get to the patient in hospital.
1, 2, 3.
That gunshot went off for a reason. What was that reason? Am I in a dangerous situation right now?
There are security concerns with that patient.
Hello, it's Jonathan Papps, an emergency.
It's a hectic day in the emergency department, so senior doctor Jonathan Papson is having to juggle treating patients and answering phones.
Yeah, it doesn't seem to run at all. It's giving me the phone, it's ringing hot.
I don't really like it much because I'd rather just be seeing the patients and sorting them out rather than being on the phone all the time.
My main aim now is to get rid of that phone.
It's crazy, the sort of stuff I get, you know, how far is Royal Melbourne from the market or something. You know, it's just the weirdest sort of stuff. What's the waiting time? I mean, I don't know any of that stuff.
That guy in Recess 5 was very interesting.
Dr. Jonathan's next patient is critically injured football player Mitchell. He's been brought in after copping a sharp knee to his side during a footy match.
He's got acute bleeding internally. It looks like his kidney's been badly damaged. He's got blood tracking down the abdominal wall. His blood pressure's low, he's shocked.
Dr. Jonathan needs to move quickly if he's going to save the 22-year-old's life.
Has he had something for the pain?
Yes.
So the kidney looks mush. I'm gonna get some more ultrasound juice and I'll show you what I'm seeing. Ah, he's bleeding. What's the worry? Bleeding to death. That's what the worry is.
Something unexpectedly bad is going on with Mitchell. So already I'm thinking, ah, this is a big problem.
How long does it take to make
things? Instantly. So if you're still sore, you need more. So let me just show you what I'm seeing so you have an idea. So this is actually worsening.
I see a whole lot of badness, which is hard to characterise on the ultrasound. Really, what we need is a CT scan.
Oh, he's next to the scan, is that right?
Partner Olivia is racing to be with Mitchell, but he's deteriorating fast. Dr. Jonathan needs to get an urgent CT scan to pinpoint the bleeding.
Let's go. I don't know how this other patient beat him to CT.
But there's a problem. There's a queue for the CT scanner. Dr. Jonathan and Mitchell have to wait.
At 5 o'clock, traumas all come at once, right? So this is what's happened. So we've got someone who's multiply injured who beat him to the scanner, and then some other guy sneaks in, knee in the abdomen. You know, that doesn't sound anywhere near as dramatic. But he's got the real deal going on. He's bleeding to death.
Back in Trauma One, Dr. Sarah Whitelaw's emergency team is treating a 20-year-old gunshot victim struck by a hail of bullets at close range. Dr. Sarah's concern isn't only for the patient.
And one thing that's really important is whether or not there's a security risk to our staff and the other patients in the hospital.
It's warm, warm.
It's such a very unknown, heightened experience to be in.
Paramedics who rushed the gunshot victim to emergency are giving Dr. Sarah and her team vital details about his injuries.
He's been shot with, we think, a small calibre gun.
Oh.
3 gunshot wounds. He's pale, sweaty. He feels a little bit short of breath,
he's
been grunting at
times. With a gunshot wound that's high velocity, high force, it can cause almost any type of internal injury. It is a life-threatening situation.
We're just going to roll you and have a look at your back, OK?
The emergency team is searching the man's body for bullet entry and exit wounds.
So, got a entry wound right mid-thoracic, just off the right of the midline, right loin, 2 on his left thigh, 1 on his left calf.
They identify 6 visible wounds. But worryingly, not all the bullets are accounted for.
X-ray there, guys.
An X-ray reveals a potentially fatal injury.
That's one of the bullets that's still left in this gentleman's chest. So this is his heart here, and it should be over in the middle of his chest. And it's not, it's squished over this side. So this lung has collapsed down quite significantly. And then the question is, has another of the bullets gone into the abdomen below the diaphragm, and is he bleeding from anywhere?
So the bullet in this patient has actually punctured the lung, and the lung itself is deflated and it's leaking air into the chest cavity. It's really important that we go in and make a small hole through the chest wall and release that air and any blood that's in there so that it stops squashing the lung and the heart towards the other side of the chest. This is something that could definitely kill this patient if we don't release that pressure.
He's become tachy.
Yeah, very, very tachycardic.
We didn't know where the other bullets were, so if there was any injuries to his neck and to his spine, that's going to stop his breathing immediately.
As the doctors make an incision for the drain, the patient's heart is starting to beat very fast. His collapsed lung is losing air and pushing harder against his heart.
He's going to give you some more oxygen, okay?
Essentially, more and more air has come from the damaged part of his lung into the chest cavity, and that has pushed his heart over further, and eventually those blood vessels to and from the heart would have become so kinked that his heart would stop beating and he would die.
Okay, so everyone ready?
You guys ready?
One, two, three. Well done.
Following a spike in trauma cases at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, Dr. Jonathan Papson's patient, footballer Mitchell, is finally getting a CT scan. The 22-year-old has potentially fatal internal injuries after colliding with another player on the footy field.
Your ongoing blood loss is deadly. It kills trauma. In this case, he's bleeding, and he's bleeding to death, and he's bleeding quickly, which is why I'm so worried.
He's had tons of morphine. Doesn't seem to help. He's in a world of pain, but he's too sick to be able to tell us, which is even worse. That looks like free fluid on the fast, though. The kidney looks damaged, but there's free fluid on ultrasound now as well.
Dr. Jonathan believes the kidney damage is critical, and urgent surgery is Mitchell's only chance of survival.
I'm hoping just to go straight to the theatre from here. The liver's flapping around in a sea of blood.
I'm not a surgeon, so I don't have the ability to do the operation. All I can do is advocate for what I believe is the right thing.
While surgeons review the scans, Mitchell's partner of 3 years, Olivia, is anxiously waiting. As Mitchell's condition is so serious, she hasn't been allowed to see him yet.
I'm just heartbroken. Heartbroken that this has happened to him, not actually seeing him, being with him, knowing in myself that he's okay.
It's definitely weird.
I'm hesitant to operate on this guy. If we do, he will lose a kidney.
Mitchell's been playing Aussie rules since he was 9. The removal of a kidney could mean the end of his football career.
He hasn't been well looking at all.
Okay.
It's been ashen, looking sick, blood pressure 90, heart rate 115. But I don't know, have you looked at him? He looks like shit. Gut feeling is, I reckon, go to theatre. Yep, thanks.
The worst case scenario is he continues to bleed through this kidney that seems to be ruptured, and he bleeds so much that he goes into cardiac arrest and loses his life.
Don't break it in
half.
All right.
You've been wonderful.
You're very welcome, not at all.
Registrar Michael Dunn's been a doctor for 6 years. He's halfway through his emergency specialist training, which he began back home in Ireland.
I do remember the first day of my job. It was absolutely terrifying. I remember being asked to put a drip in someone's hand and taking half an hour to build up the courage to actually do it, probably shaking like a leaf. I'm sure they were more scared looking at me than I was.
Dr. Michael moved to Australia 2 years ago and loves the unpredictability of the Royal Melbourne's emergency department.
One, two, three.
What comes through the front door changes every day. We see probably a new patient every 30, 45 minutes, and you have to sort of be prepared for anything that walks through the door.
Pregnant trauma, do you want me to describe that?
Dr. Michael and Nurse Lucy Stranger are heading up a team getting ready to receive a young pregnant woman injured in a car crash.
This is a pregnant trauma. Yeah. With vaginal bleeding, which is never a good thing. Try to prepare for the worst.
The accident happened more than an hour ago, so they must quickly assess both the 23-year-old and her unborn baby.
Kayla's currently 27 weeks gestation, first pregnancy. She's been struck by a four-wheel drive that was going past with a large bull bar. Probably compressed about half of the engine bay on the driver's side. Spun the vehicle about 90 degrees. She says that she struck her head on the windscreen. About 20 minutes before she got in the car was the last time she felt any fetal movement.
Kayla was leaving her local supermarket when the other car smashed into her. Partner Joe's now on his way to be with Kayla, who's 6 months pregnant with the miracle baby doctors said she'd never have after battling cancer.
Past history of osteosarcoma. She's been free of cancer for the last 3.5 years.
Osteosarcoma is a type of bone cancer that we sometimes see in the long bones, like in the legs and the arms. And in Kayla's situation, she's had 2 osteosarcomas removed, one on her right leg, and then a few in her ribs as well on the left-hand side. As a result, she's had some prosthetics put in, a metallic prosthetic in her right leg, and also some concrete prosthetics in her left ribs.
Kayla, I'm Lucy, I'm one of the nurses. How are you going? You've had better days.
Yeah.
I've personally never seen anything like this before, so it's quite a unique circumstance that we're dealing with. So for Kayla, we'd assess her like any other patient, checking head to toe to make sure that she's breathing okay, the lungs are okay, and also looking for any signs of significant bleeding.
Sorry, Darren, we'll look at the tummy now, okay?
She's got generalized lower abdo tenderness.
One of the concerns we have is that there may be some fetal distress, and that's what we use to describe a baby who's struggling. Her placenta can tear away from the uterine wall, and that can lead to significant bleeding, which puts both the mum and the baby in danger.
That's one of the bullets that's still left in this gentleman's chest. This is his heart here, and it should be over in the middle of his chest, and it's not, it's squished over this side. So this lung has collapsed down quite significantly.
In trauma room one, Dr. Sarah Whitelaw's team is carrying out a life-saving procedure on a gunshot victim whose lung has been pierced by a bullet. Police guarding the patient are on high alert as the shooter is still at large.
What we need to do is actually make an incision to drain the blood and let that lung fully re-expand. And we need to do that pretty quickly.
He's sore, that's hurting him.
It's painful to have this done. This gentleman's probably got a lot of muscle, and that makes it quite difficult to actually get in through to the lungs. There's quite a lot of blood coming out of his drain in the chest.
With gunshot wounds, you always have to expect the worst case possible. You know, some will enter and they don't come out, or they'll enter and then, you know, shrapnel just gets spread in their body.
I don't have any exit wounds.
There's no exit wound.
It's very likely that there are still full bullets or fragments of bullets still left inside this patient.
Dr. Sarah's calling in a specialist surgeon to remove any remaining bullets in the operating theatre.
Sarah Whitelaw here, one of the ED consultants. We have a 20-year-old gentleman who, within the last hour, has had 6 gunshot wounds. He's having a chest tube put in on the right.
The gunshot victim needs a CT scan urgently to locate the bullets in his body.
Are you comfortable, Annalise, with that plan? If he stays as stable as he is, that we will go to scan?
I just want to know where, because if he's got penetrating, yeah. He's got gunshot wounds, right. Yeah. I haven't had a chance to see that.
Absolutely. It's just impossible to tell from the bullet hole itself whether that bullet's gone up that way or that way or that way or that way. So if it has gone into the abdomen, then there is a chance it could be causing bleeding. We need to keep the momentum going and get him to CT.
Moving the patient just a few metres from the trauma to the CT scanner is potentially deadly.
If that tube falls out or kinks, that lung could collapse again, and that could cause the patient to become very unwell or even die.
Sorry, Darren, we'll look at the tummy now, OK?
Over in trauma two, Dr. Michael Dunn is performing an ultrasound on car crash victim Kayla to see if her baby is in danger.
The abdominal fast is okay. I'm just checking the pericardial views. Good to feel the heartbeat as well.
The first time mum-to-be hasn't felt the baby move since before the accident.
Did you say you know the sex?
Yeah, boy.
Yeah. Cool.
when we do the ultrasound and see, is there a fetal heartbeat? Is it fast? Is it slow? But it's very scary checking to see that, and particularly if you can't find the heartbeat, something that's very difficult for Kayla and very difficult for the staff as well, not knowing if we'll find a heartbeat or not.
Kayla's waiting for a sign that the baby doctors said she'd never have because of cancer treatment at 19 is safe.
There's no obvious bleeding anywhere.
Good.
So, did you hear that? There's no obvious bleeding down there, I mean, which is really good. And the heartbeat looked nice and strong. We're going to get some x-rays. And then we're going to probably go get some scans just to make sure that everything in you is good. OK, beautiful?
Yeah. Now, you understand Joe?
He'll be in the waiting room. So I'll bring him up as soon as all of this faffing about is over, because there's too many people.
Kayla will have to wait to be reunited with her partner, Joe.
Just put your arm by your side for me.
She's not out of danger yet. X-rays and scans are needed urgently to check Kayla's leg and artificial concrete ribs for fractures.
Can you shut your eyes?
Okay. Nurse Lucy goes to find Joe, who's arrived at the hospital, still in shock over his partner's accident.
Hey, mate. What's your name?
I'm Joe.
Hey, Joe, I'm Luce. I'm one of the nurses. I'm looking after Kayla.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? How you going, matey? All good?
Fine, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Do you want to go up? Do you want to go up?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's go. Family is very important to someone who is unwell. If you've ever felt any form of fear, you instinctively want someone close to you. Look who I've got. You're right, darling.
Really?
Yeah, we'll give you some more medication.
Though Kayla's been cleared of any internal bleeding or harm to her baby, the CT scans reveal another problem.
The CT scan did show that she had some fracture or a break to her prosthetic cement ribs. So we'd have to speak with the cardiothoracic surgeons and get their opinion as to whether there's something that needs to be operated on.
It'd be quite an extensive operation and may actually lead to complications for both Kayla and the baby. Given Kayla's history, I say she probably thought her scariest moments in the hospital were behind her, and having to go through this again when she's pregnant must have been quite an ordeal for her.
Kayla will have to spend the night in hospital while she waits for the surgeon's decision. Every day, more than 200 people visit emergency via the busy triage station. This evening, Nurse Julia Hoyles is working the desk, assessing patients and prioritising who gets seen to first. She's been an emergency nurse for 5 years.
Just behind that purple line.
I like doing the triage. It's one of those places where you never know what you're going to get on a given day, and it's full of chaos, and that's what I love about it.
What's up?
I've had enough waiting here, love.
I know.
With so many people needing attention at the moment, Nurse Julia is dealing with increasingly agitated patients.
We're doing our best to get you in, OK, but it's pretty busy today.
Well, why did you bother me? You got so many things.
I know.
How do I
hang tight. Just be patient a little bit for me while I see if I can find a room, OK? Very good. I'm just going to do a quick sweep around, make sure no one's left.
With beds in short supply, Julia is checking if any patients have vacated valuable spots.
Extra spare beds. I got very excited, but some of them need flood washers, so that'll be another 20 minutes or so before we get use of them.
It will take just hardly 60 seconds.
I understand that, but something like a tetanus injection isn't the highest on the priority, so we will get to it when we can.
No, so you're saying tetanus is not a serious thing?
Not a life-threatening emergency in the next 5 minutes.
But just as triage is becoming overloaded, security cameras show a potentially critical situation unfolding. A nurse sounds the alarm, and emergency staff rush to a woman who's collapsed at the triage window. The cause is unknown. In the triage waiting room, a woman has collapsed and is convulsing uncontrollably. Emergency physician Dr. Michelle Thornhill reacts to the alarm immediately.
And when a buzzer goes off, we all know what that means. It means someone's in distress. So we all look outside the cubicle, see where it's happening, and I'm the closest doctor there. So I stop what I'm doing and I run out to the waiting room to see what's going on. I find a young woman in convulsions. So I immediately run to her assistance, support her head. I'm thinking she's having a seizure.
Have you got her?
Yeah, I've got her.
So a seizure can last anything from a couple minutes up to more than 15 to 20 minutes. If it goes longer, she's at risk of not breathing properly, not being able to swallow and choking.
Before she started convulsing, the young woman told staff she'd been having seizures earlier in the day.
Okay. She had two seizures today, which is quite friends. And then this is all I heard.
Okay.
And then we pressed the
button. The young woman is coming out of the seizure, disoriented and confused.
Okay. Just a little needle to get some blood tests.
I'm at the hospital. I'm Michelle, one of the doctors.
You're okay.
Yeah, okay. It's all right, you're just at the hospital.
Thank you, no.
Jessica!
Jessica is a student from Chicago, and right now, probably feels a long way from home.
I'm starting to check her vital signs.
Sorry, Jess, just open your eyes. What? She's doing a big, big thing.
I get the nurses to attach all the monitors to her. I make sure that she's breathing well and getting enough oxygen. And then I start doing my investigations. So I take blood tests and order CT scans. Can you tell me what medication you're on for seizures? Do you know? Which ones are you on?
Jessica's having difficulty speaking because she's bitten her tongue during the seizure. So it's hard to get her medical history.
Just relax, stay nice and still. You're gonna take a tracing of your heart, okay?
Okay, was that your friend that brought you in? Yeah? Okay.
Jessica came to hospital with her friend Sarah, a German exchange student.
So we were in her room and she had an issue before. We were just waiting and then I called her mom and she said maybe it's better when you go to the hospital and then we came here.
Do you got something for this?
No. Both young women are far away from family and have bonded quickly.
What's the code? So I'm just since 5 weeks here in Melbourne, so I know her since 4 weeks now.
While Jessica gets support from her friend, Dr. Michelle is still concerned that the cause of the student's seizures remains a mystery.
I'm hesitant to operate on Sky. If we do, he will lose a kidney.
Over in Resus 5, Jonathan's patient, footballer Mitchell, is still critical after he took a forceful blow to the abdomen during his regular weekend match. He'll die if he's not operated on immediately. Mitchell's fate is now in the hands of trauma surgeons Dr. Alastair Rowcroft and Dr. Ben Thompson.
Mitchell, can I have a look at your tummy? Is that okay?
Yeah, sure. If you push hard, it's going to kill me.
Don't worry, I'm not going to do that.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, we're going to get you sorted out. We're going to get some things arranged, make some plans upstairs, OK? OK.
Surgeons are considering the removal of Mitchell's ruptured kidney, which could end his football career.
You never want to lose a kidney or a solid organ, but if it is that that's what has to happen to stop the blood loss, then that's what has to happen.
Have you been updated? Do you understand what's going on?
Yeah,
Mitchell's partner, Olivia, has been waiting for more than an hour to see him. Before heading to emergency surgery, Dr. Alastair tells her about the risks.
His right kidney is shattered.
Right.
Okay. So that causes a large amount of internal bleeding that needs to be controlled. That if you're untreated, you're going to die.
Great.
So you go in and have a chat to him.
Okay.
I'll be with you in a sec.
Yeah.
Before you go ahead.
Dr. Ben is head of the surgery department.
I know it's stressful.
So he'll stay here tonight then?
He'll be here for a while. Okay. You're right, I'm sorry.
No.
It's all a bit frightening.
Yep.
Olivia steals one last moment with Mitchell before he's taken away.
They're telling me, you know, he's got internal bleeding, so it's very important that he goes into surgery now. So you only have, you know, 2 to 3 minutes to be with him. I just had to say goodbye, and, you know, when you love someone so much, you just couldn't comprehend what was going on.
We have a gentleman who, within the last hour, has had 6 gunshot wounds. He's having a chest tube put in on the right.
Earlier, Dr. Sarah Whitelaw's team performed an emergency procedure to save the life of a 20-year-old gunshot victim. He was shot multiple times at close range and rapidly deteriorated with a collapsed lung.
X-ray there, guys.
An X-ray showed a bullet pierced his lung, but not all the bullets have been accounted for.
Walked for 10 or 20 metres after being hit and then kind of collapsed down. So I don't think he's...
We're very used to dealing with patients that can't give us a lot of history. So it is useful to be able to get information about perhaps the type of bullet. It gives us information about the damage that that bullet might do.
That confirms what we saw on ultrasound.
The CT scan reveals the dangerous extent of the damage the bullets inflicted on the victim.
The CT confirms that the chest drain is in the right place, that there is that ruptured lung and there's a bit of bleeding from the lung. There's also quite a few bullet fragments in the chest itself along the surface of the ribs and some bullet fragments around the liver as well. So it's hard to tell how many bullets are in the chest and the abdominal cavity because there's lots of fragments everywhere.
The police are obviously very keen to get the bullet.
There'll be a couple of them.
So,
Dr. Sarah is handing over the patient to surgeons who will operate on him immediately.
So I think he's going to theatre for a lobotomy.
After a marathon shift, Sarah can finally head home.
That's one of the things that I love about emergency medicine. Most of the time we manage to make things a bit better. Sometimes we make it a lot better and sometimes we save lives.
Right, I want you to just squeeze my fingers for me. As tight as you can, squeeze both sides. That's it.
2 hours ago, 20-year-old Jessica, a student from Chicago, collapsed in the busy triage waiting room. It was her third seizure for the day. And alarmingly, doctors still don't know what's causing them.
Did you have any headaches or anything today?
Jessica bit her tongue during the last seizure, making it hard for Dr. Michelle to get the information she needs.
Do you know when's the last time you had a seizure before today? 8 months ago?
So seizures are totally draining on a person having it. It's their whole body that's convulsing. So practically every muscle in their body is going into spasm and out of spasm repeatedly for minutes on end. They're really tired, they're sore all over. Probably akin to someone who's just run a marathon and used every last bit of energy that they had and then they collapse at the end because they just have nothing left.
Jessica was brought into hospital by German exchange student Sarah. Both young women are far from home, and it's times like these Jessica needs a friend like Sarah.
I come from the Caribbean.
I can definitely relate to being on your own. I mean, I came out here essentially on my own. So yeah, I do know how important it is to have people who care about you close by.
Rush,
you
this time. Hmm?
Touch
you.
Don't touch
me. And if those people aren't around, then it's good to have other caring people there who can offer you that sort of reassurance and comfort in your time of need.
Hello, Grace speaking.
Nurse Grace Curry tells Jessica's worried mother in Chicago that her daughter will have to stay in hospital.
Especially since she's staying in student accommodation by herself, I think it's more likely that we'll keep her overnight for longer just to make sure that we're not sending her home by herself to no one.
Jessica's still in danger of having another seizure, so hospital staff need to monitor her overnight.
People can die from a seizure, especially if it's a prolonged one and that's not recognised. Because sometimes you can stop the actual body convulsions, but there's still abnormal activity going on in the brain if you don't wake up.
I poked my head in here before and you were asleep, and then I poked my head in a little bit later. And there's Joe eating breakfast off your stomach. And I was like, Joe?
Nurse Lucy's patient, Kayla, was at risk of losing her 27-week-old baby after being in a car accident. Yesterday, Dr. Michael cleared the unborn baby of any harm. But x-rays revealed Kayla's concrete prosthetic ribs, which were the result of her bone cancer, had been fractured in the car crash.
How's your ribs?
Yeah, it's
better.
Yeah? No. It's still tender, but it's not.
It's been an anxious night for the young couple, waiting to hear if Kayla will need surgery to repair her ribs.
Fortunately, in Kayla's situation, the cardiothoracic surgeons assessed her and they felt that the actual plate itself had maintained its structure and wasn't actually at risk of causing any long-term problems. So fortunately, it didn't have to be replaced or repaired.
It's a bit of a special bub then, by the sounds of it.
After Kayla's battle with cancer and surviving a car crash, the couple are looking forward to the birth of their first child.
See you, beautiful. See you, Joe. We'll go back.
For Kayla and her partner, Joe, being so young and starting a young family must be quite an ordeal. We see patients at a point in their lives where they're most scared and most afraid, and we have the knowledge and ability to reassure them and put them on the right path. And I think that's a very rewarding aspect of the job.
3 months down the track, Kayla is now a mum to baby Noah.
That's hurting him. We need more analgesia.
Dr. Sarah's gunshot victim's life was saved after surgeons removed multiple pellets from his chest. They repaired his diaphragm, which had been ruptured by a bullet, a hernia, and part of his liver, all complications from the gunshot attack. He was discharged a week later. After suffering three potentially fatal seizures in one day, Dr. Michelle's patient, exchange student Jessica, was kept overnight for observation.
Can you tell me what medication you're on for seizures, do you know?
The next morning, Jessica remembered she missed taking prescribed medication before the seizures. She was discharged the next day and has returned home to Chicago. Friend Sarah is continuing her studies in Melbourne.
What's the worry? Bleeding to death.
Dr. Jonathan's patient, footballer Mitchell, was dying when he was rushed to surgery with a ruptured kidney and internal bleeding after colliding with another player on his local footy field.
Seeing him laying down, I just couldn't contain it.
It's several weeks later, and Mitchell is recovering from major surgery that saved his life.
I've probably been hit like that, you know, 100 times before, but it was just happened to be in the wrong spot, the wrong time. And yeah, it was just kind of a bit of a freak accident. They took the kidney out, it was completely ruptured. I've got a big scar from here to here. You can pretty much live a normal life with one kidney. In terms of my health, like, I was pretty happy with that, you know, that there's no serious consequences to what had happened.
For the young man who's played Aussie Rules every week since he was nine, it's been a life-changing injury.
The doctors kind of said it might be best to hang the boots up and not play again because, yeah, I've only got one kidney left now and don't want to risk it too much. It's a life changer, like, it's a massive change to my life.
What's going on, bro? Hi. How you going, man?
What's happening, boy? Hi.
Mitchell's staying positive.
I'm going to miss going out playing footy with my mates, but I just want to try and hang around the footy club as much as I can and just stay involved, and because I do love footy.
Thank you, boys.
Take care,
at our most vulnerable, these are the heroes we can count on.
He's clinging on to life.
Next Wednesday.
Gentleman has had a chainsaw injury to his head.
It will take everything these doctors have.
We need to stop the bleeding now. That adrenaline that you get can be a real fear. I'm really worried. He could die within minutes.
New Emergency, next Wednesday on 9.